Father, we thank you for Morgan and your hand upon his life. We thank you that truly your kingdom come, your will be done in the life of Morgan and Christy. In your plans and purposes for them, we join our hearts together. We join our hearts in this house of praise where you are inhabiting. We lift our voices before you, saying, Lord, that you would lead Morgan. He's decided to apply for this job, so Father, it's in the hands of other people now. And if it's the desire of Morgan's heart, and if he's been cut out for it, we're going to pray that he be chosen. Jesus, thank you, Lord. We thank you for that. And everybody said, amen. 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 Bless the Lord. Turn to First Chronicles. My wife is getting my notes for me. I left them in the office, but we're still talking about the beauty of holiness. And it's kind of shaking me up a bit. I'll tell you, a couple weeks ago or last week, I'm sorry, forgive me, I know. I think it was last week we talked about the fear of the Lord, and the Lord just, you know, is just giving me deeper insight into my own life personally, where maybe I haven't been delighting in the fear of the Lord. And then this week is kind of shook me up too. As a matter of fact, even as I've gotten ready last night and into this morning, and even as I'm worshiping, I'm seeing some things that, it's like, you know, beauty. Being in the presence of beauty, and please forget that woman at the restaurant. But being in the presence of beauty is that changes you. That has an effect on you, you know. You guys are in my presence every week. Come on, I thought that was funny. Anyway, whatever. Kath, what do you do to this, honey? Okay. Let's read chapter 16 of 1 Chronicles. Let's just read the two verses, which are really our staple verses as we trudge along, as we go forward. On this February the 8th, 2015, give to the Lord. Say, give to the Lord. Give to the Lord. Give to the Lord, O families of the peoples. Give to the Lord. Say it again. Give to the Lord glory and strength. One more time. Give to the Lord. Give to the Lord. Give to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come before him. O worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. There's a few weeks ago, I thought that I was going to talk about giving. You know, it says we're to bring an offering before him and worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. And I hope I've got you thinking about it. I know I've got some people thinking about it. I got a text that I'm going to mention from somebody who went home and did a personal study and sent me their thoughts and their own insights on what it means to be in the beauty of holiness. Last week, we looked, or Alexander started us there, and I touched on it last week. If you were to look in 1 Corinthians, you can keep your finger. I don't know if we're going to be going back there. You know, I want to read it again. Give to the Lord, O families of the peoples. Give to the Lord glory and strength. Give to the Lord the glory to his name. Bring an offering before him. O worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. It's good stuff. Go to 1 Corinthians. No, change that. Go to 2 Corinthians. I changed my mind. Therefore, you know, we could go and spend some time and see what the therefore is there for. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, therefore. But we won't, for the interest of time. It was all good news, talking about the mystery of Christ being revealed, talking about marks of ministry, talking about what it's like to be reconciled from God, reconciled to God, the judgment. Anyway, I said I wasn't going to do that. Just before that, it talks about being holy. The Apostle Paul starts chapter 7 by saying, therefore, having these promises, beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. I saw this week that they had the National Prayer Group breakfast in Washington, D.C. It was huge. The president was there, and the Dalai Lama was there, and Darrell Waltrip gave the keynote address. Darrell Waltrip is a NASCAR champion driver. He's just a redneck through and through. And his testimony is this: I was in a bad accident, and he was haughty. He was proud. He was a Dale Earnhardt didn't like, nobody liked him because he was a nasty driver. He was selfish. He was good. He'd bump people out of the way, and he told people about it. He knew he was good, and he talked about it. That's who Darrell Waltrip was. I remember when he used to race. But he was in Daytona, and he had a bad accident, and he almost lost his life. And his wife was a believer. And God revealed to him that if you would have died, you were going to hell. And he stood there at this national prayer breakfast, and he gave his testimony. He looked at the president, and I was told, and Jesus told me if I would have died, I was going to hell. And he saved me from hell. And my personal relationship with Jesus Christ is that I've been saved from hell, and I've been saved for everlasting life. Hallelujah. Yeah, right there with the president. And then the president gets up, and he says, well, God certainly works in mysterious ways. He said, who would have thought that you'd have a champion NASCAR driver delivering a keynote address under the same roof as His Holiness, the Dalai Lama? Then all the 3/4 of the people that were there, evangelical Protestants, I'm sure they wanted to say, but His Holiness. And that's, you know, we see the Pope, His Holiness. People would even think, Billy, His Holiness. You know, this that holiness thing is that something that is for the cloth, or it's something that's for higher up. It's for a certain individual. It's for God holiness. We are to worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. He's talking to the Corinthian church here, and he's talking to the Corinthian church that, I'll tell you, in today's standards, there was nothing holiness about them. They tasted and they saw that God was good. And the Apostle Paul says, therefore, having these promises, beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and the spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. You did not see my PowerPoint there, did you? Or did you? Has my PowerPoint been up there? I have a PowerPoint open there in the computer. Grant? Hi, Grant. Anyway, so it's, Psalm 19 says, the fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. I'm going to nervously ask this, you know, how am I going to ask it? Who feels really good after a good shower? Hopefully, you know, like, do you notice just a good, let me get personal. Who's ever gone to bed? This is getting a little too personal, but anyway, I shower in the evenings, normally. I always shower before I go to bed. There's times when I don't, periodic. I think, how hard did I work today? I just don't feel like it. And I'll go to bed, and I'll tell you, almost always, every time I wake up, I'm thinking, ugh, am I the only one? Now I see shaking of heads. Can I get a witness with a hand raised? Like, great faith here today. Can I get a witness, Grant? Yep. Okay, there you go. But, you know, and you work or you just, you know, I'm going to assume that we all like to feel clean. We all like, you know, like if we're dirty or whatever, don't worry if you guys don't cooperate a little bit more here, I'm going to start talking about dung. No, don't do that. The fear of the Lord is clean. Yeah, I remember I was memorizing Psalm 19. I was reciting it, and Alexander stopped me in my tracks. He goes, that's interesting. What, say that again? I said, the fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. Now think of that. And let me read verse 1 again of 2 Corinthians chapter 7. Therefore, having these promises, beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. You remember the fear of God? Whoa, how great is God? Let's go back to our lightning show and our thunder and just amp it up higher than that. Oh, that's the fear of God. Oh, He's awesome. And He's awesome towards us. Holiness is a person. Holiness is the person of God. It's the presence of God. Holiness is a place. It's just the surrounding. It's who God is. God is in the business of working in us holiness. Someone sent me a text who'd done a little study, and they said, Rick, I guess the best, somebody from here, I guess the best definition I have that I can see from looking at the scripture and looking in the Hebrew is that the holiness of God is like an adornment. Oh, it means adornment. It means something absolutely beautiful is what holiness is. We're called, as we've seen in scripture, to be changed from glory to glory, regardless of how old we are, whatever is going on. I kind of think I'm getting better looking as I get older, but anyway, is that as we get older, as we go on, we become something more glorious. That's scripture. We're changed from glory to glory. Yes, from the inside out, but I even feel it affects our outward appearance. Just look at me. One laugh, that's good. And it wasn't my wife. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. And then he said, and I had to recheck this. I think he said to us that we are a light to the world. And I went and looked at it in Matthew. No. He said that Victor Clausen is the light of the world. He didn't say Victor is a light of the world. He said Victor Clausen is the light of the world. You and I, being perfected in holiness, become the light to the world where I live. The problem is that some of us get so wrapped up in it that we got our high beams on all the time. I thought that was good. I really thought that was good. We live our lives as like we got our high beams. What happens, you know, Grant and I are trying to get together because I've got a car that's got one of the beams out, and sometimes, well, a lot of the times I have to drive with my high beam on, so I know what it's like to annoy people with high beams. I know what it's like. We have somebody in this very congregation, and he will remain nameless, but he knows who he is, who shared with me about someone who he knows that just doesn't seem to portray Christ in a way that he thinks Christ should be portrayed in. And we were talking, he told me about this guy, and I said, is this guy by any way? And I just said the name. He goes, you know him? Yeah, I know him. I know him very well. I'd like to think he's changed from glory to glory, and I'm going to believe he has. God's still working in him. And I bring this here for a reason, and if I didn't have this happen in my life over the last couple weeks or even yesterday come to a pinnacle, I would have formatted this message just a little bit different. I know of a person who I had somebody complain, a person who used to come to this church in the 80s, and somebody came and complained to me about them by the way that they conducted themselves in business. And he told me something about this gentleman who behaved in a public, in a certain manner in a public forum that didn't surprise me. It didn't surprise me because I knew this guy. And it was stunting the faith of the person who was telling me this. Oh, well, he's got to deal with it. I didn't show him any sympathy. I didn't join the bandwagon of criticizing this guy. I tried to get it back to his own relationship with the Lord. And just recently, in the last year, on three different occasions, the last one being yesterday, I saw this person in St. Catharines behaving in a way that I think, oh, come on, please. And one of the ways was I saw him walking at a certain place where he thought he should be walking across, and a car came, and they didn't stop well enough for him, and he got angry. He got angry and waved his hands and walked away. I thought, oh, man. And I just stayed away. I didn't want to make sure he didn't see me. And yesterday, I was walking at this same establishment, and I came walking up, and I thought, this person's going to run me over. I stopped. They got tinted windows. I looked. It's him. He almost ran me over, and he's getting mad at me. He's looking at me, but then he saw me, and he waved at me. It was foggy and kind of thing like that. My thought is, hopefully I wasn't judging, but I think maybe I was a tad. Get your high beams off. Because these people are also very vocal about their faith. And the message here this morning is that we're perfecting holiness and the fear of God. We're worshiping the beauty of holiness. We're praising the beauty of holiness in a manner that brings us closer to God, that brings glory to God, and changes us and equips us for this life we're living. So I owe it to you as a pastor to follow the Lord's leading and talk to you about what it really means to give to the Lord, O you families of the peoples. O give to the Lord the Saylors, the Hothams, the Steeles, the Conleys, the Warrens, the Clausens. O give to the Lord glory and strength. Give to the Lord the glory due his name. So I want to talk to you a bit this morning about giving. And I think we might even go into a bit of it next week. And it's not about money right now. I heard someone say, they were asked, very wealthy church, very well-known church, and the pastor was asked, how often do you talk about giving? He goes, every Sunday. You talk about giving every Sunday? Every Sunday. Or are you talking about money? Oh, you're talking about money? I talk about once every 3 years. I talk about giving every Sunday. Interesting. That's where I want to take us this morning. Go to Matthew chapter 7. If we're going to give to the Lord, all you families of the peoples, if we're going to give to the Lord glory and strength, we're going to give to the Lord the glory due his name, bring an offering before him and worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. It's not just for church, folks. I'm having my own little therapy session here as I'm sharing that story with you. Oh, let me read this to you. I have to read this for you. This is another signpost for me. This is a book. I think, Alexander, you bought this for me. Did you not? Yes. You're probably glad to see I'm reading it. This is Brian Zahn. Brian Zahn, him and Bill. Between Brian Zahn and Bill Johnson, there's not been two. They're about the two strongest voices in depositing in my life the last couple of years. I just have to read this. I said to Alexander, I was going to preach a little bit from it, and I'll just read it. And this caught me by surprise. The book is called Beauty Will Save the World. I've been reading it for almost 7 months now. Yeah, one of those books. I want to know where to start. Our first priority as a church is not to make all these things happen in the world through political action, but to be a prophetic witness to the hope of a world remade according to Christ. Please let this be the one. Yes, it is. Okay, I had to take a run at it. Anyway, every redemptive action, political and otherwise, must proceed from our faithful witness. In the midst of a hateful, violent, and idolatrous world, the church is to be an enclave of love, peace, and holiness. To be a faithful church, the church must be distinguished by holiness. Not holiness as puritanical moralism, but holiness as otherness. Now I got all excited. I was just reading this week. I'm thinking, yeah. We are to be other to the values of this present darkness. Christian holiness is not based upon a certain set of rules, but upon the fact that we are from another time. If we approach holiness as a legislative issue, we are prone to get it wrong. And even if we are not wrong in our judgment, we are likely to be ugly about it, haughty, condemning, and condescending. Holiness is not that. Holiness is not moralism. Holiness is not legalism. Holiness is not puritanical rule-keeping. Holiness is otherness. Holiness is prophetic untimeliness. Holiness is the transcendent beauty that comes from belonging to the redemptive future. Holiness is a preview of the world to come. Holiness is a picture of the beauty that is to be. To live now according to the beauty that shall be, because the future belongs to God, is what the psalmist means when he says to worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. We are holy when we are other. We are holy when we transcend the dominant paradigms of present corruption. We are holy when we are from the future. Does that do something for anybody besides just me? That was so good. That's about the eighth time I've read it. I figured he could say it better than I did, so I didn't try to memorize it or formulate it into my own notes. Holiness is that we're from another world. We have this hope within us. You know, Gwen is getting ready to go home and be with the Lord. And it's the rubber meets the road. Eduardo Gonzalez sent me an email this week. Be in prayer. We're looking at going into Cuba in March. We just heard back from the people there. And when Victor and I and Brian went to Holguin on the back of that truck back in 1993, we met Eduardo's younger brother, Joel Gonzalez, who was the professor. He was a colorful guy and cares, well, I don't know, how do you describe him? He was fluent in 7 languages, if I remember correctly. Yeah. And then he moved to the States, and Eduardo sent me an email. He died of a heart attack the other day. But Eduardo's words just convicted me, thinking, oh my gosh, you're right. We're from another place. I saw in Eduardo's email, the beauty of holiness in the midst of great loss. We're different people. We're a peculiar people. It's not behavioral. We've all fallen into that trap. It's something transcendent. It's something miraculous. That the fear of the Lord. See, Jesus delighted in the fear of the Lord. And of all the work the Spirit did in Jesus, what's the greatest work he did in him that was done in him? We saw this last week in Isaiah chapter 11. He did the fear of the God work, the fear of the Lord in Jesus. And Jesus delighted in the fear of the Lord. Because it changes us from glory to glory. And change always costs. Change always takes effort in anything. I'll get to the chairs later. Matthew chapter 7, verse 1 and 2, and then we're going to go to Luke. You can put your finger in Luke chapter 6 if you like, if you want to move things along and get to the communion table. Matthew chapter 7, verse 1 and 2, and I will get to it right now. I only have three ribbons in my Bible to mark scriptures, and it is, judge not that you not be judged, for with what judgment you judge, you will be judged, and with the measure you use, it will be measured back to you. That's key here for us to remember. I forget what I named the message. Give and it will be given to you. Judge not that you may not be judged, and with what judgment you judge, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured back to you. Go over to Luke chapter 6, please. These are kind of parallel verses. Matthew's writing, and then Luke's we'll look at, goes into a little bit more detail. Luke chapter 6, verse 37. He says, judge not, and you shall not be judged. But he goes further. Then he says, condemn not, and you shall not be condemned. And then he says, forgive, and you will be forgiven. And if you look at the last part of verse 38, he says, for with the same measure that you use, it will be measured back to you. You judge, you won't be judged. You condemn, you won't be condemned. You forgive, you'll be forgiven. This isn't talking about our relationship with Jesus, even though it is connected to it. He's talking in how you live life here on earth with fellow human beings. But isn't it interesting? If we were to read this again, judge not, you shall not be judged. Condemn not, and you shall not be condemned. Forgive, and you will be forgiven. Then I took you right to the very end, for with the same measure you use, it will be measured back to you. And that's basically judge and what Matthew said, chapter 7, verses 1 and 2. But look what Luke adds. Let's read all of 38. He says, give, and it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over will be put into your bosom. For with the same measure that you use, it will be measured back to you. I've come to believe that that's not talking about money. I've been to churches that have used that verse of scripture for giving of tithes and offerings. Even though This is the DNA of this verse is sowing and reaping. That's how the kingdom of God works. So yes, that does work for money. But where we find this particular verse, it's not talking about money. It's talking about how we give judgment, condemnation, or not give judgment, or not give condemnation, and forgiveness, or not forgiving to other people. The scripture clearly says here that if I decide that I'm going to be in judgment on Linda, I'm going to be judged in the same manner. Not only that, it says if you give, it will be taken. It will be given to you, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over will be put into your bosom. Now that's talking about the positive aspect of it. If I decide not to judge Linda, not to condemn Linda, and to forgive Linda, but we don't always do it. And you can just skim by this verse of scripture and think, well, I'm not in judgment of anybody. I'm not condemning. That's a strong word. I'm not condemning anybody. I try to forgive. It's a daily. It's a lifestyle. Something I have to do every day. I don't know who's going to tick me off today. but I'm ready. And as I've looked at it deeper and as I've examined my own life, I think, oh my goodness, this is speaking to us today. And if God's going to work in me, holiness, perfecting it in the fear of the Lord, we skim by the fear of the Lord. Who has ever been guilty, I don't want to use that word, not at the communion table, but who's ever skimmed by the fear of the Lord? I have. The actual meaning of it. And I get challenged, and oh my goodness, I've been challenged in the last 3 weeks of just living in the fear of the Lord. He's still answering. I got to stop singing that song, Open the Eyes of My Heart, Lord. He keeps answering it. He shows me more. But God's for us. He's not against us. God's not judging. He's not condemning. And he's forgiven. That's who he is. That's why we come to the table. That's the work he's doing in you, Paul Swatsky. That's the work he's doing in you, Judy and Lynn. And you, Denise. He wants you to be givers. He wants us to be givers every day. So let's look at it. And I feel the Lord has given me some particular insights, not just for me, but for us here, because we all beat with the same red blood and exist on this terrestrial ball together. Let's look at judge. As I looked at that word judging, okay, I think of judging as, that's it, I've judged you. But, you know, as I considered it some more and I looked at the Greek and I thought, yeah, it means to pass judgment. But what does the judge first do? Because the condemnation is to pass judgment. Condemnation is to basically make a proclamation of guilt towards someone. Basically, I'm saying no hope. At least not if I'm a judge. At least for 7 years, you got no hope. You ain't getting out. If we think of it in a law and order kind of sense. So if we back up and we looked at judge not, how am I, I'll pick on myself, how am I to make sure that I'm not judging? How do I judge? And as I looked, you know, the second or third word, when you looked in the Greek, it means the way we think. Ooh. The way we think. You mean the way I think towards someone, I could be in judgment of them? I just wrote some things down here. I said, we judge, and I said, do we? Not just verbally or by action, but not just the way we think. And if you look further in the Greek, it's what we listen to. So I was thinking of this. I was at a few establishments yesterday where the public was present, where people talk. It's called Starbucks. And this was professional development. And as I was sitting there, I listened to conversations. I determined to stop reading and to listen to conversations. Fairview Mall at the Chapters, last night, going to get stuff for here. Don't let me fool you. If they didn't have stuff for there, I would have still been down there. But anyway, I was sitting there, I listened to some people I listened to three different conversations. All three conversations were about other people that weren't there, who had caused some sort of an offense, and they were talking about them. And it wasn't malicious, you know, I'm thinking, oh, that's what we do. That's what we do. It's in their thoughts, it's in their conversation, and we judge. So let a man examine himself. I'm thinking, okay, I can, you know, I try to steer away from it, but it happens so easy. It does. And we do it. And the scripture just kind of went, boop, highlighted itself. One of those types of Bibles. Judge not so that you won't be judged. Remember, it says in the same manner that you don't judge, it'll be, you know, you get, it works reverse. In the same way that I judge, I'll be judged. I'll be thought about. I'll be spoken about. This is speaking to me. I'm being called to a deeper level of worshiping the Lord and praising the beauty of holiness. I can sing the song. I can stand up and have your mouth off about it. Give to the Lord, you families of the peoples. Give to the Lord glory and strength. Give to the Lord the glory due his name. But you know, when I start listening and thinking about and talking about others, I'm judging them. That's what it means here. I'm judging them. Apostle Paul says, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just. And I believe the old King James says whatsoever for every one of them. Whatsoever things are of good report, if there be virtue, if there be praise, think on these things. Now, I have it memorized, but I want you to read it. Put it up there in the screen for me, Ephraim, to Philippians chapter 4. It says, and the things, is it not, did I not put it there? And the things which you learned and received, heard and saw in me, these do, and the peace of God will be with you. I'm telling you right now, if we think negative thoughts, if we think nothing, I'm not saying to deny the obvious. That means you should be praying for people. Just if we think and we're talking and we're not talking and thinking in an area of helping the people or helping the situation or taking our issue with God. We are personally hijacking the peace of God in our lives. The Apostle Paul says, he said, the things which you learned and received, heard and saw in me, these do, and the peace of God will be with you. If you don't, the peace of God ain't going to be there. Second is condemning, which is a pronouncement. It's a passing of sentence. It's basically saying, no hope. My mind is made up about that person. My mind is made up the way they behave. My mind is not made up about the person who almost ran me over yesterday. But it can be. I have to make a quality decision. I have to be still and believe that God will be large and be exalted in this person's life. I do. And if I don't, I've condemned him. Oh, Rick, they're strong words. I know. I have said, there's no hope for you. I have to practice this on a regular basis in working with the Ministry of Teen Challenge. And I think that's what I've asked God. Lord, why am I so involved in this? Like, is this fleshly? Like, am I doing this on my own? And he's revealed to me, and I don't say this in a proud manner, I'll come down a step. I've been graced with the faith to believe for them. And I don't say that apologetically, but I realize I got to fight for it. Alexander and I went up to a graduation a few weeks ago for Max. Max was here. I've seen God use me to be in Max's life at least 3 different times throughout the program that kept him in the program. I didn't go looking for it. I saw God work it. On a Friday night, we're going to go to London, and we're going to go to graduation. So 2 and 15 minutes there, 2 and 15 minutes back. Starts at 7 o'clock. All day, I was telling myself, yeah, you don't have to go up there. You really don't have to go all the way up there. And then Alexander said to me, hey, I'll go with you. Well, that makes it easier. All right. The church is gracious. Whenever I go to Teen Challenge to do chapel in the mornings, I try to get a room at a good rate, Teen Challenge rate, at a hotel there. Okay, we'll go and we'll drive home. Alexander and I will share the drive. I think you drove both ways. You did. And we went there. But here are the thoughts, the judgments that I battle with. Is that, and I say this cautiously, you know what? The odds are, this guy's going to stumble. This guy's going to struggle. I've been here before. I see it. The percentages has gone down a bit, unfortunately. Hopefully it comes up with new management at the Teen Challenge. It's just Christmas Eve. Oy, oy, oy. I felt the Lord said in my heart that we should Wednesday chapel. I was talking to people at the Teen Challenge. Who does chapel on Christmas Eve? Oh, we don't have anybody to do it. I talked to Kathy. I'm not trying to be a martyr. You know me well enough. Hey, Alexander, you want to do music? Sure. So Alexander, away we went. We went the night before that one, didn't we? Went the night before. We went. And you know, when we got to the graduation, let me go back to the graduation on the Friday. We pulled in the parking lot. The church was filling up. And what car pulls in right beside us, Alexander? Max and his parents. Who's the first person that comes up to me and goes, Rick, I cannot believe that you drove all the way up here for this. And then he looks at me and goes, I didn't even want to come. Because he was already out in Welland. They have family members. We have people in our own lives that we have condemned. That we say, we think this. There is no hope for that person. I'm just gonna pause and say, Selah. And let us think about the people in our lives that we have or the people we know of. And we've had thoughts, maybe words or actions or lack of, because we just think no hope. And I believe the scripture says very clearly that if they need anything from us, they don't need me, they need our faith. Love is this: it bears all things, it believes all things, it endures all things, it hopes all things. Love never fails. Never. On that note, this is John. John is our graduate from Sault Ste. Marie. John is now phase 4 intern at Teen Challenge in London. He just moved there tomorrow. He moves there tomorrow. I have a stamped envelope with a card. You can continue to pray for him. He is now self-sufficient. We have his last name even. They've released that. He gets paid by Teen Challenge. He does night duty and things like this. He's got to support himself. And who wants to pray for him and send him a card and say, John, congratulations on your graduation, and just encourage him. Kenny. It's on my chair right here, buddy. But it's not all about Teen Challenge. It's about the people we work with. It's about the people we live with. Let's get to forgiveness. Judge not, you shall not be judged. Condemn not, and you shall not be condemned. Forgive, and you will be forgiven. This is easy. I'm going to simplify this. You ready? The person owes you nothing. If you've had to forgive someone, the person owes you nothing. Not even an apology. That's large. That reverberates in me as I thought of this and as I wrote it down, I'm determined to say this, is if you've forgiven somebody, they owe you nothing. And if you're good with that, you've forgiven them. Who's ever forgiven somebody and they thought, or somebody, I saw someone forgive someone and they said, and you owe me an apology. They owe you nothing. That means you have forgiven them. I have nobody present in my life. You know, Kathy and I had an interesting week a couple weeks ago, but we've gotten over that. No. But really, in my marriage, if anything, I have got my nose out of joint thinking, that woman owes me an apology. And I know, and I'm sure she's thought the same about me, but I forgive her because I have to live with her. I made that vow. I signed that certificate. I have the microphone right now, thank God. But I remember specifically thinking, she owes me an apology, and I've allowed it to go on too long. I can't think of anything in particular. I can remember the season. I can't even remember what it's about, thank goodness. But she owes me an apology. That's not forgiveness. When I reached out to Glenn Wood and we went and met, and I felt he owed me an apology. But I was going to sit with him and I was going to say, Glenn, whatever I've done to you, I'm sorry. And I did. He said, that's okay, Rick, that's okay. What are we drinking? You want a cup of tea? And I'm thinking, no. You owe me an apology. I went there so high. I drove there thinking, yeah, this is good. We met, we left. And then we left. He didn't say he was sorry. I drove home and I was holding that steering wheel like this. He did not say, and I felt the Lord, what were you expecting? Have you, Rick, you haven't forgiven him. You just told him you forgave him, but you haven't. But he owes you nothing. Nothing. And we know how God healed that, don't we? I never tied that scripture into as I learned to practice that. And it says, I'll say it again, give and it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over will be put into your bosom. For with the same measure that you use, it will be measured back to you. And I say, praise the Lord. How do we live? On a promise. Whose promise? God's.
God's. And the promise was sealed by blood. I am so glad I got that out of my system. That, my friends, is the truth. That, my brothers and sisters, is the word of the Lord for us all today, that we are to give. We are to give what God gave to us. God so loved the world that he gave. I choose to give. I choose to believe. I choose that my believing is going to be in the way I think and in the way I listen. And I will have hope for all men and walk in forgiveness all the days of my life. Let's come to the table. A promise that cannot be broken. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. I've never seen, Hebrews says, the righteous forsaken, or the seed, his seed begging for bread. And the same night in which he was betrayed, giving thanks, he took the bread and he broke it. He said, "This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Taking the cup, I almost had a holy moment at Costco yesterday. Now I told you where I was. About four jugs. That's where I get the grape juice for communion. And for the first time ever, really, that's twice in a row. I'm looking forward to my third time at Costco. Last Saturday night, I had gone there to get some things, and I saw Stephanie there. And I said to Stephanie at church on Sunday, I said, "Wow," I said, "it's just like, I mean, seeing you there and in the midst of all these people, and it was like seeing the beauty of holiness. It was worshiping the Lord in the beauty of holiness." I was wired for that. That was my mode of thought on a Saturday night. As I picked up the jug of Kirkland grape juice for communion, as I picked it up, I looked at it, And I had a moment. I had a holy moment. And I felt God saying to me, "What you're doing, what the church does in light of communion, is large. It is large. This is not a magic juice." I've said that before. But I felt God saying to me that the obedience, the steps of faith taken at this table, by not just you, Rick, but by the people of Life Abundant Niagara, truly is transforming, truly is a part of the changing from glory to glory, just as this simple grape juice becomes the blood of Christ. It was his idea to have us come to this table and drinking this juice, representing his blood. A promise made so that we can be people that give. We give not condemnation. We give not judgment. We give love. We give hearts of forgiveness. And I would suspect, I would wonder, I would say this morning that in the area of forgiveness, not just because this is an easy one to grab a hold of, but maybe even with the judgment, our thoughts and the things we listen to. Well, let's go all three in the condemnation, that there's some people that are believers, and in my own heart, I view them as having no hope. I haven't been believing for them. I haven't been bearing all things, believing all things, hoping all things, and enduring all things. And I think some people owe me. I really do think some people owe me. I tell you, no, they don't. And as you come to the table and take the bread and take the cup, my prayer is that the eyes of your understanding have been enlightened, that God has so much more to give to you. As we deal with these issues on a daily basis. But there's some history that needs to be taken care of here this morning. There's some history and there's a fresh start. And yeah, we're going to be doing this at Life Abundance. Some of you here got to practice it right now. Right now, you got to practice it right now. And I don't mean to be flippant in front of the communion table. But some of you probably don't like what we've done for the chairs. But we have. That's okay. I don't like how you're sitting in the chairs. The aim is to make the church look a little fuller and maybe move you up a little bit more. But life, just living life. But there's history. There's history. There's present. There's present history, if that's such a term. There's something right now that you want it to be history. That, you know what, I'm just not thinking right. I'm listening to the wrong things. I'm speaking the wrong words. My heart is not believing for individuals, and there's some people that owe me, and you want to leave it at the table. Come to the table here this morning, right now.